Hello everybody and welcome to this week's CERN Google Hangout. Now if you were following us last week, you might remember we were bringing you bang up to date with all our latest LHC results, divulging the secrets of the Higgs, telling you also how little we don't understand dark matter and bringing you up to date with antimatter and all the rest of it. And if you missed it, don't worry, you can catch up with that or any other Hangout on our CERN YouTube channel. It's there waiting for you. Now, in all our discussions last week, with all these wonderful results, we were focused on where we were going to go next. And where we were going to go next always required more data from the LHC. And that very neatly brings us on to the big question in today's Hangout. Where is the data from the LHC? Why do we have no beam? Why have we had no beam since February 2013? Was it to let us very slow experimental physicists catch up with all the analysis, or was it for some deeper reason? That's what we're going to be discussing today. And I'm delighted that joining me here in the LHC Universe studio is Mike, who is head of the operations of the CERN's Beam and Accelerator group, Claire, who works for the same group but concentrating on LHC operation. Hi, thanks both of you for coming along. And I'm thrilled that live, 100 meters underground at the LHC itself, we're also joined by Mirko, who is another LHC operations guru. Hi, Mirko. Thanks for joining us from down. And finally, our social media maestro is live from the social media hub that is Belgium. Hi, Freya. Thanks for handling our social media.
Hi, Freya.
And just to remind you all, if you have any questions at all on the LHC, why we're doing this, where it's going to go next, then you can send them in and we'll try our best to answer them in the Hangout or we'll catch up with them afterwards. So on Twitter, ask us questions with AskCERN hashtag or just type them in on the Google page, on the YouTube channel, or on the Facebook page and we'll pick them up. Okay. But before we get started on finding out the LHC's innermost secrets, it's time for the trivia question. And Mike, would you like to tell us what this week's trivia question is?
Okay. The aim of the game is to produce as many collisions as possible in the center of the experiments. One way we do this is to have lots of bunches going around the LHC. And the trivia question is, how many protons per bunch do we have? Let's say in 2015, what's the nominal number of protons per bunch in the LHC?
Right, so there you have it. There's this week's challenge. How many protons per bunch in our proton beam in the LHC? Send in your answers, and we'll read out the winner at the end of today's Hangout. Okay, but let's start off by talking about the LHC and why we have no beam. So, Mike, first of all, let's start with you. Why aren't we running? Why are we in a shutdown?
It's to give the experiments a chance to catch up with their data
analysis. No.
Two part answer. First of all, the LHC is 27 kilometers of highly technical, highly complex systems ranging from magnets, vacuum, cryogenics. And all these systems need a lot of tender, loving care over an extended period for maintenance, consolidation, so they can run with high reliability when we restart with beam operations. That's the first part. The second part is goes back to 2008 when we first started up the machine. We, in September the 10th, we put beam around. About 9 days later, we had a rather catastrophic event in one of the inside the cold magnets, which took out about 500 meters or so of magnet, required a lengthy, very costly stop for repairs. And analysis of the event identified a weakness in the splices, the joins in the cables, which carry the current between the magnets. Okay, and this is in the same so-called interconnects. The Kate's outlining this at the moment. So there's 10,000 of these joins. And during 2013, 2014, all these interconnects have been opened up, the joints have been measured, and about 30% of them have been repaired. And that's been the big, consolidation effort.
Right. Because we have been running happily with the LHC up to 2013 and delivering hundreds of trillions of proton-proton collisions. So Why were we able to run there, and why do you want to do this work there?
Okay, so analysis of the weakness in these splices led us to conclude it was safer to run at lower than design energy. So in 2010, 2011, 2012, we were working with about 3.5 TeV and then 4 TeV per proton, whereas the design is 7 TeV. So what this consolidation during the last year and a half will allow us to do is go up towards the design energy of 7 TeV.
Right, so far we've only literally been running on half power, I think. Well, perhaps not absolutely literally.
We call it the 3 years we were running as run one. As you say, very successful run, discovery of the Higgs in 2012, of course. And we've learned an awful lot about how to run the LHC, how to produce enormous amount of collisions. Of course, we're going to use that experience in run two, which starts in 2015.
Okay, so now you know why we shut down. It's because the LHC is like an expensive car. It needs maintenance, but we also want to make it go a lot better, go a lot faster. So, KS, what sort of work are we doing in the shutdown to get there? What's going on?
So, there are many things going on, and the most important one is already highlighted by Mike. We have to repair these interconnections. And there are a lot of work around, but LHC is not only interconnections and it's not only magnets. We have many other equipment that we profit as well to upgrade, to change, or to improve. For example, one important system is the quench protection system, which has been fully upgraded. We have as well upgraded the RF system. We had to change one of the RF cavities.
So what does the RF cavity do?
There are frequency cavities. So these are in 0.4, and they are one of the elements that allow us to keep these protons within a bunch and also to accelerate the beam to higher energy.
So these RF cavities are the thing that makes the beam goes fast, essentially, that does the accelerator and the Large Hadron Collider.
Yes, this is one of the components to accelerate the protons. We also work on the collimators. We upgrade the collimators. These are material that we use to absorb the particles that try to run away from the core of the beam. This is very important because if these particles hit our vacuum chamber, they will warm the magnet, they will heat, and then they will quench. Mm-hmm. And this is to be avoided. So the collimation system is there to protect quenching the magnet. And this has been upgraded as well.
So this quench is, this is the big problem that Mike told us about in 2009. Well, it wasn't a quench, was it?
Well,
it was
involved. Well, just explain what a quench is. So the LHC magnets are superconducting. So they're cooled with superfluid helium at 1.9 Kelvin. And the current, the very high currents, are flowing inside a superconductor. And if this which basically has zero resistance, and if this superconductor heats up a little bit, it will go resistive. And then we have a high current flowing through a resistance, and you get resistive heating, and it can seriously damage the magnet if we don't capture the quenches, switch the magnets off, and extract the energy.
Right, so that's the process that went on in 2009.
That process took place in the superconducting cable that was between the magnets.
Right.
So not actually inside a magnet, but in the cables that passed between the magnets.
Okay.
Which are superconducting, they're sitting in superfluid helium.
Okay, so
yes, we have as well profited to upgrade our control software, our injection system. Mm-hmm. We have improved our injection magnets, our extraction magnets to dump the beam in the beam dump system. We have as well improved the vacuum to get even better vacuum in our beam pipes.
Gosh, because I always thought that the LHC vacuum was one of the best around, because I know the fact here, it's 10 times less than the moon's atmospheric pressure. That's the sort of vacuum that you're dealing with in the beam pipe, so it's going to get even better.
In some places we had issues, for example, around 0.2 where that is, there were the vacuum there was higher than expected, and the experiment had some problems to get good data, so this has been improved. It's better for round two, and hopefully the experiment will be happier. And we have as well upgraded part of our beam instrumentation to be able to see better our beam.
Okay. So you're telling me that you put the beams into the machine and you don't know where they go? I'm sure that isn't the
Plus or minus a few microns.
Yes.
So it's actually it's
high precision then.
No, I mean it's very high. So the beam size in center of Atlas, for example, is about let's say about 50 microns. So this is the diameter of a human hair. Mm-hmm. And we have to steer the two beams into each other. So we do that by extrapolating from beam position monitors. And of course, the more accurate the beam position monitors are, the better we can make that extrapolation. So that's just one potential use of these improved diagnostics.
Gosh, it's fascinating. So there is literally a huge amount of work going on every aspect of the whole accelerator facility.
Absolutely.
And maybe Mirko, maybe I can come to you down in the LHC tunnel, because we've just heard of this incredible amount of work. Perhaps you could bring us up to date with where we stand with getting this work done. How much of it's been completed up to now, and what sort of work is going on at the moment?
Yeah. Well, first of all, hello everybody. So, we are here in the tunnel just because there is no beam, because normally when there is beam in the machine, nobody is allowed to access the tunnel. And this is a very rare occasion to show everybody connected now the tunnel here behind me. I'm actually here at point 8, which is one of the points where we have access to the tunnel. On the other side, there is LHCB, one of the experiments of the LHC. What you see maybe here, the aluminium plate here, is just one of the plates where we had to open. And yes, we are just moving a bit to show you. So you see this is the connection between two magnets. And it is inside here that we have six connections between the let's say the lines that are powering all the magnets, because the magnets in a sector, roughly 200 magnets, are all connected together. And inside here, opening, you find all the lines that you have to cut before finding the cables, and all the activity has been done on this. Unfortunately, we cannot see inside because indeed, coming to your question, all these interconnectors have been opened, the cable being consolidated, and we reclosed them. In fact, yesterday we had the last official closure of one interconnector DLC, and we open again. Probably we'll have to open again some of them later, but officially the work of consolidation now is over. So as Mike said, we have almost 1,700 of these connections between one magnet and the other one, six busbars inside, which makes almost 10,000 interconnects for the whole 27 kilometers of the LHC. And on all of these, we had roughly 260 people working on the consolidation activity, opening, cutting, soldering, doing a lot of work during the past 14 months. And in 14 months, we've done really a huge work to consolidate this machine and being able next year to go up to the design value for the terms of energy. So
now that you've finished checking out the interconnects of the magnets, what's next?
Yeah, finished is not really we have finished the hardware part, most of the hardware part, which was really the opening, the machining, the soldering and resoldering for the splices that were not good. Now that everything has been closed, we are still to test under vacuum. Roughly one sector. We have eight sectors in the LHC. We need still to test under vacuum, the insulation vacuum, let's say. Inside here, we have the cold mass, which is insulated from the external via vacuum. And so we have to test indeed that it is all these cryostats are leak tight. This will be accomplished by, let's say, in 3 weeks' time. And at that point, we can consider that the consolidation of activities are over. Still, we have to cool down all the sectors. First of all, we have to pressure test, which is pressurizing all the lines inside to check that all the welding that we have done on all the lines, they are perfectly tight again. And then we have to cool down all the sectors. For the moment, we have cooled down a single sector, which is sector 6-7, and we have still to cool down all the other seven, which means essentially that up to the moment where the very last sector is not cooled down, we cannot say that all the consolidation activities have been accomplished correctly. So once everything will be cooled down, I would be really happy, and at that point we can consider that the LS1 activity is really over.
So Mirko, I have another question for you, actually, which is, I was reading about all the work that was going on inside the LHC, and one very small part of all the shutdown work was the replacement of 15 of those long blue magnets you're standing
yes.
next to. And this
yes.
fascinates me. The LHC is huge. It's 27 kilometers long. You're 100 meters under the ground. Those magnets are 15 meters long. How do you get them underground and to the place that they're meant to go?
Yes, sure. Well, first of all, maybe we can come back. We're actually now in a passage which has been left indeed for the passage of the magnets, just in case like that, in case we need to pass with a magnet to replace magnets in some places. About the magnets you were mentioning, 14 of them finally had to be replaced for several reasons: electrical problems or limitation that were limiting us really in energy for the operation, and for which of course we had to take actions to go up to the nominal design energy. Replacing a magnet is not an easy activity. It is something, first of all, that has to be done, can be done only with the machine warm, because of course inside here, as Mike said, there is a liquid helium cooled down at 1.9 Kelvin. So first of all, we have to warm up a full sector, so almost three kilometers of a machine, before opening the interconnect, disconnecting the magnet on the two sides, so taking it out and transporting through the tunnel where we are now. Through, you see the huge space that has been indeed left for the passage of the magnets. There are several positions in the LHC where we can leave the magnets on surface and of course lowering down the replacement magnets. Each of these magnets is 30 tons roughly, and so you can imagine the effort in not only in doing the activity of reconnection and so on, but also for the transport is quite it is not so trivial. We have special if you want a track which connects to the electricity to the rail on the top, and then it's transporting the magnets outside, and a complex system for lifting them and put them in position. So it is not an easy activity, and I repeat, it is something that can be done only in a long shutdown when the machine is fully warm up.
Thank you. I've always wanted to know that, because every time I go underground, I wonder how on earth you can get these things into place.
We need about 40 men to lift one of the magnets out. Okay.
I believe everything Mike says, because he is an expert.
If I may, in 2008, when we had the problem, when we had the incident, at the time we had to take out from the tunnel 51 magnets. Not all of them, because they were damaged, but essentially a part was damaged. Others were had components that had to be replaced, cleaned, and so on. It was done in less. Finally, it was done in less than 1 year of the activity reconnection and so on. No, even less if you consider that you have them to cool down. So it was a huge effort at the time. This time we had, let's say, 1/3 of the magnet to be taken out. It was quite a easier job. Indeed, we have many, many other things to do. So.
Exactly. That bit might be smaller, but you have plenty there. Joshua, thank you very much for giving us the overview. Now we understand at least why the LHC isn't running, because there's far too much to do to get it to its optimal tip-top performance. So perhaps now, Freya, can we go to you for some questions on social media? Give us a question that people have been asking, and we'll do our best to answer.
Yeah, hi, everyone. So yes, I think I would also like to invite everyone to ask your questions specifically about the LHC, because, of course, a lot of people are interested about in the physics, but we do so many hangouts about that. So what's next week, or what's the one last week? And we can answer those questions then. So, but if you have questions about the LHC and how it's being built and what we're doing at the moment, ask them now. So I have this really good question at the moment, which is from Mufasa on Twitter. And he actually asked, at least I assume it's a he, he asks, how many kilometers of cables are there actually in the LHC? It's a good question.
How many kilometers of cable? Right, Mike, do you want to have a go at that?
There is a huge amount. There is a huge amount. It's really, you know, there's cables for every different individual system. So we have cables for the vacuum, cable for the beam instrumentation, cable for electrical distribution.
I'm looking at the LHC tunnel. All I can see is
cables trays. those trays up above Mirko's head there, you can see some of the, you can see the density of cables there. And that's all the way around the 27 kilometers. So I think you can multiply 27 kilometers by a couple of hundred at least.
That'd be like 100, yes.
I mean, this is safety system, access, interlock cables, electricity, beam instrumentation signals. I mean, an enormous amount of cabling. I mean, one of the big activities of the long shutdown has been recabling some of these systems, and so we subcontract this work out, and these guys are still working hard, finishing up on the recabling.
But I really want you to give everybody a sense of just how enormity of the amount of cable in the LHC. So take those superconducting cables, for example. And tell us, if you untwisted them, down to the filaments, tell us just how long that is.
So the cables which are wound inside the magnets, the superconducting cable, this is called Rutherford cable, that was invented in England, is made up of strands. And the strands, how many strands per cable, Mirko?
There are two kinds of cables. One of them has 28 strands, and the other one has 36. So the inner layer and the outer layer.
Yes. So if you if you look at the strands themselves are actually made up of filaments.
Yes.
So it's about 60 filaments per strand.
There are some 7,000 filaments per strand, something like that. 7,000-8,000 filaments per.
So if you take all the filaments, unwind all the magnets, they would stretch from here to the sun and back again 5 times. And then there's enough left over for a few trips to the moon, apparently. And I forget.
It's just huge, absolutely huge. And all these filaments are just stuffed into one type of cable that threads throughout the LHC.
Yeah, well, when you say cables, if you start talking about the magnets, you're into a completely different ballgame, because these, of course, are wrapped. They form superimposed loops inside the magnets. So, I mean, it's huge, huge.
Great. Well, I hope that gives you an idea of just how complex the whole thing is. So, Freya, give us another question.
Okay, I have another question from Twitter, but you YouTube guys, should also continue to ask questions. So I have a nice question from Daniel Yund? I don't know. Anyway, he's on Twitter, and he asks, with this additional magnets, and I think this is something you guys have to also explain, how much additional magnets we really have, because I think they're mostly upgraded, not added, and this double power that we have, will CERN have to cut down the number of hours we have to run, or the time we run over the year?
Ah, good question. So maybe I can direct that one to you. So when we run with the LHC, we don't just run 365 days a year to start with, do we?
Well, as you said, we didn't add new magnets on top of the existing ones. We replaced magnets that were not functioning according to the specifications. So the number of magnets is the same, but what is true, we will double the energy. And then, only then, we will meet the specifications of LHC. So the right energy, 70 eV per beam, and the right luminosity. So 10 to the 34 in terms of luminosity. So we were not running at full speed up to now. We were below, and now we will start running at full speed. So it's now when the story really starts for us. So we will keep the same time, because then is when we will be producing the Higgs we promised to the experiments every day.
Wow. That would be fantastic.
just to make a point there, the actual energy usage that CERN will place on the grid at this higher energy is not very much more than it was at lower energy.
So to put it in context, just what is the typical energy usage of the LHC when it runs?
So the whole complex, so the CERN, when the CERN's accelerator complex is running, the LHC is going full blast, is about 180 megawatts.
So that sort of Canton of Geneva size?
No, it's about 10% of the Canton of Geneva. So the LHC is a big, big industrial user, but it's not.
That's great, because somebody on the YouTube had that question, Lachlan Citizen. So it's wonderful that you answered that already.
You should see our electricity bill.
Do you actually get an electricity bill?
We do.
Does it come with added discounts for high usage? Wonderful. So Freya, any more questions that have come in?
Yeah, I have a really good question, actually. I think I already know the answer, but I think it's an easy one. But I think it's also interesting to talk about this. So are the tunnel lights on or off when the LHC is operational, and does it make a difference?
Are the tunnel
lights, James on Twitter.
Thanks, James. Are the tunnel lights on or off? Actually, like a fridge. But let's try Mirko. Mirko, did you catch the question? Do the lights go off when we start up?
Yeah, if the lights are on when we run with the beam.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, of course, the particle need the lights to follow the path. No, I'm joking. No. Actually, we try to switch them off when there is nobody, but we are not always so attentive. So from time to time, they're left on. But we could switch everything off. But honestly, the consumption is really small compared to the. It is not the lights that give the full bill. Fairness might say that. If I may, coming back to the question of before, indeed, the fact that you are using superconducting magnets makes that the fact that what we are putting, once we are energizing them, which means putting the current inside them, we could even unplug the magnets and the current will continue flow inside. So essentially, they don't consume anything apart the energy which is used to feed them. What is the most of the consumption for the LHC goes on the cryogenic plants, which are the plants which produce the liquid helium to cool down these magnets, and also warm magnets and other elements that are, whose consumption is really much more than the one of the superconducting magnets.
Yeah, the superconducting is so important, because that's the reason that the LHC can achieve these huge energies. The previous accelerator in the tunnel used conventional magnet technology. It wasn't quite the same type of accelerator at all in terms of the particles that it circulated, but the energy it could get to was really tiny compared to what we can do now. So,
well, there are
is the key to this.
Yeah, there are actually a couple of reasons for the use of superconducting magnets. If you want to have a magnetic field of 8.33 Tesla like the LHC, using a normal conducting magnet built in copper, you should build a huge magnet for having this kind of magnetic field, and also iron saturates, etc., etc., while the superconductors are much, they can do the job in a much more compact way.
Thank you. Yes, so they're the reason that we can afford our electricity bills and the reason we can get there. Well, I hate to cut off our discussion because there are so many questions that we could ask, and in fact, I would quite like to ask to find out about the LHC as an experimental physicist. But I'm afraid our time is up, and we're going to have to bring this to a close. But before we finish, let's not forget we have a trivia question. So it's time to find out the answer to the trivia question. So, Mike, can you remind us?
The question was, what is the nominal number of protons in an LHC bunch?
And the answer?
The answer, if you look in the design report, is 1.15 times 10 to the 11th protons per bunch. So this is 100,000 million protons per bunch.
100,000 million. And how many times do they collide per second? 40 million? It's just... I'm going to get a problem. So Freya, do we have a winner? Did anybody manage to guess that?
Yeah, there were many people who got the right answer, and within like 4 or 5 minutes. So I think there's some honorable mentions here. So Vaibhav Chimalgi and NPEC 93 were very fast, but not fast enough, because the fastest person was Jedi Princess on Twitter, who in 4 minutes, more or less like a minute after you asked the question, already gave the exact answer. So I suspect you did some Googling. But well done.
Wow, but congratulations. Congratulations to everybody who got that one right, because it's not a number that one typically has on the top of one's head, unless perhaps you're Mike or Hayes or Mirko down in the LHC. Well done. Okay, that brings our hangout, this week's hangout on the LHC, to a close. I hope now you know why we have no beam at the moment, and we haven't said, but we're going to start up with beam probably around next Easter. But the only thing that we haven't touched on, bringing you back up to date with what's been happening at CERN, we've told you about our physics results, we've told you about the LHC upgrade. I've just seen an LHC technician cycling behind Mirko.
You can yes, see indeed. It's a colleague of mine.
The one thing we haven't brought you up to date with yet are the status of the experiments themselves. And that's going to be the subject of next week's Hangout. So join everybody here next Thursday for the Hangout to find out what's going on with the LHC experiments. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.